Coming up on Friday Night Live, what to do when you are in desperate need with Pastor Dr. Ested in Herndon.
Good evening and welcome to Friday Night Live. I'm Reverend Dr. Ested Herndon, the founding pastor of Hallelujah Temple. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you and praise you, Lord God, for this day. Thank you for this time. Thank you, Lord God, that we can come boldly to the throne of grace and there obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We need your mercy, Lord. Move in a mighty way. Give me the words to say, Lord. And Lord, let my speech and my preaching not be with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Move in a mighty way, Lord. Lord God, touch the hearts of the hearers, and I pray that you'll save someone, that you'll lift someone's heart. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for the power that's in your word, because you said faith cometh by hearing. Use me for your honor and glory, and I thank you now. Amen. All right, I would like to take just one moment to share with you a word of God. We're living in some desperate times, and they used to say desperate times require desperate measures, but you got to be careful how far you go. Some people may end up stealing or lying or selling their body or doing all type of things at extremes, thinking that that's the only thing that they can do. But I have an answer for you today out of the word of God, out of the Gospel of St. Mark chapter 10, verse 46 through 52. And the title of this message is What to Do When You Are in Desperate Need. What to do when you are in desperate need. Now, desperate for one person is different than desperate for another. Desperate actually is defined as reckless or dangerous because of despair, which means loss of hope or urgency. Having an urgent need or desire. Desperation is an active state, and it's the abandonment of hope impelling to a furious struggle against adverse circumstances with all disregard for consequences. So many times when people are desperate, they don't think about the consequences. They're looking for immediate gratification. They're looking for immediate results. It's a final and ultimate effort. It's giving your all, and yet it's done in such a reckless way. In the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 through 52, it reads, "And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." Let's stop here. And so we see here that this is a bad place. It's called Jericho. And Jericho was a cursed city, which you know that Joshua and the children of Israel, when they first entered the promised land, they destroyed the city of Jericho. Jericho was a walled city, and it was one of their first victories. It was a blessing because God allowed the walls to fall down. Well, the Lord also had Joshua curse everything within the city, and they actually cursed the site, saying that no one should build on this site anymore. But people did, because Jericho is actually an oasis. It's an oasis in the desert. It's very vulnerable, but there was water and wells there. So people will go to that location and build again. But it was cursed by the man of God. And so he came out of a bad place. And sometimes people are born on the wrong side of the tracks. People are born in an unattractive situation, a terrible environment. And it's not just a matter of where you were born, but sometimes it's a matter of where you are. You could have been born in a wonderful situation, but where you are right now is totally different. And it puts you in a desperate light and in a terrible light. And so first of all, we see that he's in a bad place. He's in Jericho, a place that was cursed. And then also the Bible says that he was blind. He could not see. He was handicapped. He was physically unable to see, which took away his ability to make money and to be employed. Certainly that is another strike against him. And then the Bible says his name is Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus. Bar means son of. And this name, Timaeus, is very interesting. It means an unclean man, a perverse man, a nasty man. And so apparently his mother was very upset with the father and named the boy Bartimaeus, son of a perverse man. So he had a terrible stigma. He had a terrible name. He was the ugly duckling. He was the black sheep. He was ostracized. And do you know, words really hurt. You know, people used to say sticks and stones can break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Words can hurt you. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. And it's terrible how people are are belittled, how people are bullied, how people can be put down by, from one group to another. And certainly when it's within the family, when even your parent has given you a name like that, to Bartimaeus, he is carrying a terrible stigma, born in a terrible place, and he is blind. And then the Bible also lets us know that he was a beggar. And so he is in the lowest state. He sat by the highway side begging, seeking alms, seeking handouts. He was dependent on the mercies of people. He was asking repeatedly in an inopportune way if people would help him and have pity upon him. You know, and you know, the Temptations had a song years ago called Ain't Too Proud to Beg. And in the song, some of the lyrics were, please don't leave me. Don't walk out that door. I know you want to leave me, but I refuse to let you go. If I have to beg and plead for your sympathy, I don't mind, because you mean that much to me. I heard that a crying man is half a man with no sense of pride. I can go on and on, but he's saying, I'm not going to let pride stop me from begging you. I want you to stay. And you know what? There's a correlation between begging and persistent prayer. And if you are desperate, pride got to go out of the door. You can't worry about how you look. You can't worry about how you sound. You can't worry about who sees you. You can't worry about what people may think. Sometimes you got to get ugly calling on the name of the Lord. And so we see that Bartimaeus, praise God, was born in a cursed city. He was blind and physically handicapped. He was the son of an unclean man and was belittled with a name that gave him a negative stereotype. And then he was also a beggar. And in this case, with all these strikes against him, it would have been easy for him to take on the persona of a victim. It would have been easy for him to get angry at God and say, God, why did you let this happen to me? And sometimes that's the attitude we can take even in this pandemic. Why did I lose my job? Why did my loved one pass away? Why did I get sick? Why did this happen to me? And we can take on anger and we can look against God and try to charge God. But thank God that blind Bartimaeus, even in the midst of all of this, we got to give him credit. He did not become immobilized. He did not become paralyzed. He didn't, you know, look at his situation and say, well, I don't have a spouse. I don't have a job. I don't have a child. I don't have a degree. I'm lonely. He used what he had. And one of the first things you got to do is you got to make peace with what do you have. And guess what? He could hear. He could hear. And you know what? Faith cometh by hearing, hearing the word of God. What you're doing right now in hearing this word is really powerful, because if you let this word take root in your soul, it can produce power within you so you can go forward and connect with the power of God for you to become what God would have you to be. He heard that Jesus was passing that way. And the Bible says he also had a voice. He cried with a loud voice, the Bible says. And he says, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. What he did was he used what he had. He could hear and he could speak. He couldn't see, but he could hear and he could speak. And in his speaking, he cried out and he was confessing, Jesus, you're the son of David. He was confessing his faith in the Lord. He was confessing that he believed that Jesus was the Messiah, because that was the term that the Jews had for the Messiah, was that he's the son of David. And so here we see blind Bartimaeus hearing Jesus pass, hearing the crowd. He inquired where these people were coming from, and he seized the moment. And as we begin to go on, the Bible says in verse 48, and many charged him that he should hold his peace, but he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And you know, it's so important that we understand that it's only by God's mercies that we are not consumed. God is so merciful to us and God is so gracious to us. But do you know what? People can sometimes try to block you from your salvation, block you from your deliverance. Some people actually take advantage of other people's weaknesses and their desperation and use them and abuse them. The crowd told him to hold his peace. Shh, be quiet. You're disturbing the processional. You're disturbing the parade. But you know what? In the crowd, those folks could see. Those people had the things that Bartimaeus didn't have. And sometimes people will look at you and try to determine for you what you need to do. Hallelujah. And you know, the Bible always speaks of the crowd. And in general, the crowd is an impersonal group, but many times they're a barrier. They're a block between that individual who has a need and Jesus Christ, who is the answer. And you have to learn how to get beyond the crowd, get beyond people's opinion, get beyond those those who are naysayers. Get beyond those who will try to have that check me out spirit and criticize and analyze. When you're desperate, you got to press beyond the crowd. You got to ignore the crowd. You got to push to where you can test Jesus, because Jesus is the answer. Jesus is what you need. The crowd didn't have Bartimaeus's problem. They could see they had a different station in life. The folks were trying to shut him up, but they didn't understand how critical his condition was and how in desperate need he was. He needed a breakthrough. He needed urgently a miracle from God. And I don't know if that's the case for you today, but if you need a miracle from God, hallelujah, call on Jesus. Praise God. Seize the moment. Cry out the more louder. If you have to cry out loud in your apartment, you have to cry out loud in your car, if you have to cry out loud in your bathroom, if you have to cry out loud wherever you are, cry out and call on the name of Jesus. His name is above every name of things in heaven, of things in earth, of things under the earth. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name given under heaven among men whereby we must be saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it and are safe. When you call on Jesus, that's power in the name of Jesus. There's deliverance in the name of Jesus. And blind Bartimaeus, they tried to shut him up. They tried to cut him out. But he said, no, I'm going to seize this moment. I don't know when Jesus is coming back this way. I don't know if I'll ever get another chance to even be within earshot of him. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me today. He wasn't even talking about next week. He wasn't even talking about next year. Today, I need a miracle. I'm desperate in need of your power. Have your way in my life. And the Bible says Jesus stood still. He got Jesus's attention. When you cry out to God with your whole heart, when you seek the Lord with your whole heart, God will come through. One of the beautiful things, even about the tarrying service, when you accept Jesus into your life and you want to be filled with the Holy Ghost, we cry out to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It's not vain repetition. There's power in calling on the name of Jesus, and you will get God's attention when you call on him persistently in faith. Jesus stood still. Jesus stopped the processional. Jesus stopped the parade, and he called and commanded him to come. The Bible says in verse 49, and they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. So now they're commending him. You got his attention. Go ahead. The master wants to see you. And he, casting away his garments, rose and came to Jesus. He threw off his beggar clothes. He threw off what he had on because he expected a change now that he has gotten in touch with Jesus. You turned my mourning into dancing, the psalmist says. You've taken off my sackcloth, my grave clothes, my mourning clothes, and you have girded me with gladness. Today, now is the acceptable time. Today is the day for salvation. Jesus stopped and called for blind Bartimaeus, and he asked him, and this is very interesting. The Bible says in verse 50, hallelujah, 51, Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? Now that's interesting. He's obviously blind. But do you know what? God has a principle that he set forth in this earth that we must make our requests known unto him. God knows what you have need of, but you got to share with God what you have need of. Matthew 7:7 says, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be open unto you. Matthew 21:22 says, and all things whatsoever we ask in prayer, believing, we shall receive. And so God is looking for you to make your request known. That's what prayer is. Part of prayer is supplication. Lord, supply my need. Lord, do this for me. And I want you to know many thousands, millions down through the years have called out to the Lord, asking him to deliver them from alcohol, deliver me from drugs, deliver me from perversion, deliver me out of this abusive situation, deliver me, Lord God, from my low esteem, deliver me from depression. And they called to the Lord, and the Lord heard their cry, and they began to get strength down on the inside to change and to be transformed so that the things they used to do, they're not doing anymore because of the power of God in their lives. One of the beautiful things about the Lord is that God is merciful, God is forgiving, and God will throw our sins into the sea of forgetfulness and remember them no more. He will remove them as far as the east is from the west. And then day by day, moment by moment, we honor the Lord by making those choices that will please him and honor him. And that's how you grow from one state to another, from a babe in Christ to a mature believer, is by every moment taking that moment and giving God praise, glory, and honor. But we got to call on the Lord and trust him. And he cried out to Jesus. He threw off his beggar clothes, and he came to Jesus and said, "Lord, that I might receive my sight." And the Bible says, hallelujah, Jesus said, "Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. See, he made it clear, "Lord, I want to receive my sight." He made his request known. Pray. And we say it all the time, to pray big. Believe God. Be honest with God. Share with him your problems. Share with him your concerns. If you're feeling anxious, if you're feeling worried, if you can't sleep at night, if you're losing your appetite, if you don't know what to do, if you're receiving pressure from other people to do things that you know you shouldn't be doing, or you're involved with stuff that you know you shouldn't be involved with, call on Jesus. Jesus is here to help you. Jesus is just one earshot away. Cry out to the Lord. Mother Rita Carroll from my old church used to say, the late Mother Rita Carroll, "Ain't no harm done calling on Jesus. Ain't no harm done calling on the name of the Lord. I got my soul saved calling on Jesus. I got my body healed calling on the name of the Lord. There's deliverance in the name of Jesus. There's healing in the name of Jesus." What to do when you're in desperate need? Hallelujah. Number one, use what you have. Praise God. Number two, seize the moment. Hallelujah. Number three, call on the name of the Lord. And then number four, discard the old and expect the move of God. And then lastly, make your request known unto God. Call on the name of the Lord. Bartimaeus was born in a wicked city. He was born in a terrible situation. He had a bad name. He had stereotype. People never thought anything of him, but he called on the Lord and got Jesus's attention, and the Lord delivered him and he received his sight. I'm looking for a miracle. I believe God is still working miracles. God is still answering prayer. God sees where you are. God cares for you. Call on the name of the Lord. And if you have made the commitment in your life to the Lord, let's call on him and call and seek him for more of his spirit. Seek him for wisdom and revelation. Seek him for boldness. Seek him for him to open up our understanding to his word. Let us intercede for other people and pray for this nation and pray for this world and pray against this pandemic. And let's believe God to catapult the church and the body of Christ to a whole new dimension. Let's believe God for our unsaved family members to come in. Let us pray and intervene for them. Call on Jesus. Power is in the name of Jesus. His name is above every name. So what to do when you are in desperate need? Call on the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for blind Bartimaeus. Thank you, Lord, for his persistence. Thank you, Lord, that he didn't allow the crowd to dictate to him his actions. Thank you, Lord, because he had faith in you and he acted upon his faith. We know faith cometh by hearing the word of God. And Lord, it's easy for us to be isolated now. It's easy for us to take in things, Lord God, in a passive way off of the internet and through streaming videos and things. But Lord, help us to take some active time to pray and to call on your name. You know the things that are going on in our hearts. You know our inadequacies. And Lord, there's someone under the sound of my voice, Lord, who may have strayed from you, who may not be keeping your word, who may have gone into temptation or feel totally inadequate and think that you could never forgive someone like them. But Lord, you care and you see. Touch them right now. Heal them right now. Give them a heart to call on your name in the name of Jesus. It's not vain repetition to call on the name of the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and let us use all of our strength and might and what we have to call on Jesus, and let us expect a move of God. I love you. I'm Reverend Dr. Estead Herndon. If you would like to be a blessing to this ministry, download the app for Hallelujah Temple Park Forest, Illinois, the Givelify app, or you can mail it in at Hallelujah Temple, 1 Dogwood Street, Park Forest, Illinois. If you have any prayer requests, you can also mail that in to the church. God bless you, and may the Lord keep you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah Temple is a religious, nonprofit organization. Our heartfelt thanks goes to everyone who continues to support this ministry, whether through Givelify or by mail at 1 Dogwood Street, Park Forest, Illinois, 60466. Your contribution to Hallelujah Temple helps further the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Stay connected to us through our Facebook page for more words from our leadership.